go to UCSD from 03 to 07. I guess I'm not old. I didn't have a chance to respond. I went to six colleges. The sixth college! Woo! I was actually the second ever class at sixth college. Okay, it was pretty crazy. Back in the day, it was like 300 people at sixth college. It was really small. I'm going to let you know a little bit about myself. I graduated UCSD with a communications degree. Communications? Woo! I chose that degree because I talked to the counselor. It was the easiest degree. She told me. She confirmed it. And the reason why that mattered is because when I was in college, I was actually on scholarship to go to the Marines. So I'd wake up at like 4 in the morning, come back at 11 o'clock, go to class, and do all that stuff. So I wanted the easiest major possible. And trust me, communications is really easy. If you don't know already. Okay. And after that, I actually left the Marines. It's a long story. But I just graduated from Bethel Seminary this summer with a Master's in Theology. I'll also come back to my preaching today, so pay attention. And as someone said before, I do now work for OMF International. It's a missionary agency. You can go look us up on Facebook. All right, OMF International. And I do take trips to China. I lead teams out to Shanghai about twice a year. Okay, and tonight's text, we are in Matthew 25. If you have your Bibles, take it out. If you don't, put it up on the screen, right? All right, and this is the newest NIV, 2011 NIV. Matthew 25, I'm going to start with verse 14. Tonight we're talking about, the theme's going to be your four-year plan / unity. Give me two themes. It's okay. I'm not going to vote that. All right, I'm going to use, you guys probably know this, it's a parable of the talents. This NIV translates talents into bags of gold, which I'll show you is actually a little bit better from the translation. So let's start in verse 14. And I will read it and follow along. And again, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his wealth to them. And to one he gave 5 bags of gold, to another 2 bags, and to another 1 bag, each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. The man who had received 5 bags of gold went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 bags more. So also the one with 2 bags of gold gained 2 more. But the man who had received 1 bag went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. This is a popular passage. It's probably not new to a lot of you guys, and it's popular for a reason. I think that this passage is popular because in all of Christendom, right, in all of Christianity from like, you know, 0 AD to now, there have always been Christians who have squandered what God has given them, and there have always been Christians who just did amazing things for God, right? And so, and I think in every generation of Christians, they come to this passage and they examine their lives and say, God, who am I? Am I the one with 5 bags of gold, right? And by the way, in the old translation of talents, a talent's about $1,000. Am I the one with like $5,000? Am I the one with $2,000? Or am I the guy who throws the talents or bags of gold in the ground and wastes it, right? And I think some of you guys are feeling that, right? You guys come to college, you're like, oh, am I wasting my life, right? Am I really just here to go to school and get a job? Or is there something more to my life? I'm gonna share some stories of my own life. Hopefully you can relate to some of these. All right. When I first read this passage, right, and I started thinking about like, am I the guy with 5 bags of gold, right? Am I like just super talented at life? Like everything I do is like ridiculous. And I go on Facebook and people are like, dang, he's so good at everything. Is that my life? Or is that my life that 2 bags of gold? Like, go on my newsfeed, like every once in a while, something interesting. Okay. Or am I the guy who just like Facebook stalks because my life is like so sad. Okay. It's like, oh my gosh, he got, you know, burrito tonight. Man, I wish I had a burrito. I'm gonna tell you some stories and you kind of figure out what my life is at. So when I was in college, right, I told you guys I was in the Marines. So you guys never know this, but since college, you guys still live in Camp Snoopy, right? So you guys live still? Yeah, nods? Okay. So Camp Snoopy, you know that parking in front of it is Gilman? That used to be student parking. What? Students used to be able to park there. Okay. So my story starts like when we were freshmen, we all moved in, we're like, hey, this is pretty cool parking. You know, the parking spot right there. When I went to the Marines, I left at 4 in the morning, okay? So I left my parking space, that was awesome. And I came back at 11, you know, the parking space is gone, I parked like in East Parking, right? So I'm like, all right, I'm a smart guy, okay? I'm on scholarship in the Marine Corps, I'm clever, now I'm gonna go to UCSD. What am I gonna do to get this parking space? So what I did was like, okay, if I do something crazy, right, I'll get in trouble and like bad things will happen. If I do something funny and yet it works, then I can get in trouble, but I'll always laugh off, right? So I studied the signs that they used for reserved parking, okay? And I'm like, okay, so they use this font, and they always use this kind of sign, right? And I noticed it's just like those like regular, like, you know, this kind of signs. So I just, I took one size to my room, I went to my printer, I used Times New Roman font, okay? It's like really cheesy, like 20, size 20 font, and I just typed in reserved parking. I stuck it on the sign. And 4 a.m. in the morning, no one was up, right? So when I leave my spot, I'd put the sign there, reserve parking. Right? And I thought, like, if somebody asked me why am I doing this, I'm like, I'm reserving it for myself. Right? I'm just being honest. I'm reserving it for myself. It's not official, right? I didn't have any ambiguous safety codes on it. Like, it's reserved for me. And I came back, guess what happened? No one parked it. Right? Don't try this at home, okay? Now that the secret's out. Alright? And actually, I found something. If you park to like the very left of the spot, it never will work. If you park in the middle of a row, it'll never work. Right? So I figured, like, okay, I gotta put the left, you know, most of the spot. And then after a while I started coming back, there was like people who were like, you know, parking people walking around. And I noticed they all had yellow jackets. Right? So I'm like, okay, I can take my sign away, but it'll be suspicious if I'm with a sign. So whenever I move my sign, someone in a yellow jacket. It's super far away. It looked like I was part of the reserve parking. This story illustrates. What do you do when you hide your talents? You hide your bags of gold. Right. Actually, I think in my freshman year, of all the smart things I did, that might have been the smartest thing I've ever did. Okay. I tell that story because I feel like some of us can relate to that. Right. I feel like some of us can relate to just like, you think about all the things that God has given in your life. Right. And you look at like things you've done for God in your life. And sometimes you might feel like, what have I really done tomorrow? Right? What have I really done with my life? How have I really honored God with my life? There's hope for you tonight. First thing I want you to notice in this text, all right? When Jesus calls people, right, and calls people to do things, all right, this is other teaching of Jesus. When does Jesus ever call someone to be a professional? This is Bible trivia. When did Jesus ever call somebody to be a doctor? Right? Luke was a doctor. When did he call Luke to be a doctor? When did Jesus call someone to be a builder, right? The Apostle Paul, he made tents. Did Jesus ever call anybody to a profession? I can only think of one time when Jesus called someone to a profession. He actually called someone out of it. He called someone to be a fisher of men. He actually calls them out of a profession and puts them in a spiritual profession. So if you think about that, then, right? What is this passage about? Is it about physical ability? Is it about just intelligence? Is it about what job are you doing? It's not. Okay, it might be a little bit, okay? Because that's really part of who you are. But I think more than anything, this passage is talking about something deeper. If Jesus calls people to be fisher of men, if Jesus says, blessed are the peacemakers, right? Blessed are those who are meek, right? Blessed are those who suffer for the kingdom's sake. And these guys start talking about bags of gold and talents and things that God has given us. What is he calling us to do? when we talk about 4-year plans tonight, my question to you guys is your 4-year plan from God? Is it about profession? Did God call you to this place tonight, right? Because he needs you to be a doctor. Does God call you here tonight because he needs you to be an engineer? Like there's things that need to be built. God needs you to build them. Maybe. But what I'm saying is that what I see in this text is that more than anything, what God wants you to be is a peacemaker. Someone who's meek. Someone who's an evangelist, who loves the broken, who's a fisher of men. Right? I think those are the things that God's calling you to. I think when you look at this passage, it's really easy to just really focus on like, okay, God, what are my talents? What are the things that you've given me? Right? I can sing. Or I'm intelligent. Right? Or like, I can build cars. But more than that, right? More than that tonight, I want you guys to think about what are the ways you bless God? Right? I'm not talking about social things now, right? I'm talking about things that you can't just naturally see. What are the ways you love people? What are the ways you worship God with who you are? Right? I told you guys with all the cleverness of my UCSD degree, all I do is make a parking sign. Right? I had the opportunity to go to China. And one of my partners in China, I think after observing his life, I realized just how God really works. In Shanghai, we work with an orphanage, right? is an orphanage. It's actually run by a guy from Ohio. He's actually really funny. He's like 6'2", like 250 pounds. All right, so this huge white guy in China. Everyone's like 5'1", right? So like this huge white guy. All right, and he was a plumber. He was a plumber in Ohio before in China. So like, I remember first meeting up with him. He's like, I'm gonna open an orphanage in Shanghai. I'm like, dude, you're like super white and like, you don't speak Chinese. Right, so he's super awkward. He's like, no. I'm gonna open an orphanage for like girls with disabilities. Right, and like, it's only gonna be for girls from like, you know, junior high, high school, so I can still, you know, help them get to college, and they'll have physical disabilities. The reason for that is China has a one-child policy. So if you're a farmer, right, you have one child, what gender do you want? Probably boy, right? So a lot of these girls get basically abandoned. If you have one child and your child has a physical disability, what do you do? Abandon them. So in China, especially rural China, there's a lot of girls and with physical disabilities were abandoned. So he opened an orphanage to pick up these girls and just bring them to school, connect them with Christian jobs, things like that. And in my head, I'm thinking like, dude, it might work for a year or two, but it's not gonna succeed. Like, you're just like, you know, you're a plumber, right? Like, you're Chinese, I don't understand how it's gonna work. I've been working with them 6 years, and I've had the chance to see a bunch of these girls, right? Probably at least 50% of the girls who go through the orphanage and become Christians. Some of them are actually ready to go to seminary and be evangelists in the countryside. When I look at his story, right, I'm looking like, dude, you're an overweight guy, he's like 52, right? Like, you're an overweight guy from Ohio who has no Chinese, and God is using you. I'm a guy from UCSD, I got a master's in theology, and I made a parking sign, right? Like, with all my skin and all my dreaming, the best I can come up with is a parking sign, right? Which is kind of lazy to think about it. I'm going to Marine training, run like 20 miles, come back, I got to like park closer because I'm lazy, because I don't want to walk the distance back to my class. God uses those with one talent, right? God uses those who are given one bag of gold. I hope for those who are here tonight, who are thinking about, you know, what are some ways I'm going to serve the church this year? What are some of the ways I'm going to bless God this year? I hope you feel underqualified. Okay, I hope you feel underqualified. Because I've never saw a passage in the Bible that says, God, I'm Pharaoh's son. The thing you call me to do is really lame. I want to conquer. I want to do something bigger. Right? Or God, I am so good at preaching. What you call me to do is too easy. Right? You never see that. Everywhere throughout scripture, right? Moses, for example, I can't do this, God. I can't do this. Right? Look at the apostles, they're like, dude, we're just fishermen. I don't really know what you want from me. The servants of God have always been qualified. Alright? And actually, if you look at this passage actually hinges around the fact that God's talking to the one with one bag of gold. So let's go back to the text. Let's keep going. I'm in verse 19. In verse 19, after a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who received 5 bags of gold brought the other 5. And master, he said, you entrusted me with 5 bags of gold. See, I have gained 5 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. And the man with 2 bags of gold also came. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 2 bags of gold. See, I have gained 2 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I'll put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. Then the man who received 1 bag of gold came. Master, he said, I knew that you are a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid and went out and hid your gold in the ground. And see, here is what belongs to you. All right? Notice God says the same thing to the first two. Right? The 5 says, God with 5 bags of gold. What, master, the things you have given me, I have made double. Alright? Second guy comes back. You gave me 2 bags of gold, I made 2 more. And here's something interesting. I don't know if some people read it this way. The master could have been like, well, I'll give you 2, you couldn't be the first guy. I actually read it that way, but I saw it like in my like overachieving mentality. Right? Like, if I was like down with 2 bags, can you make 2? Alright, dude. One day left, I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna make 2 more bags of gold. It's like I make 1 that guy. All the master expects is that to make a return equal to what they were given. Right? You see that 5 plus 5, 2 makes 2. So the guy with 1, I mean, he only has 1. And so he's like, well, I got the least. So the master trusts me the least. So that means I'm super high. And the story pivots around that. Okay? So the guy with the 1, it's kind of funny if you think about it, he focuses on the 1. Right? Because if you think, the master already made how much in return? About $7,000 in return. Right? What's another 1,000? That's not the point of the story. Right? The master doesn't focus on just the overall return. Because you think like, master, dude, you get 7,000, I'm being greedy. Right? I don't understand. You make $7,000, all you do is take a trip. You know, you come back, you want free money. That's pretty lazy. Right? The story pivots around the idea that someone wasted the bag of gold. It's the idea of waste. It's not about gaining whatever it is, right? It's the idea of waste. Another story about when I was in college. Actually, my freshman year, after my parking sign, right? It was actually really clever. I stopped doing it because I felt bad. After that, in college, I started serving with Harvest Church, okay? And actually, serving with Harvest Church, I started to realize, God started bringing these to mind. You know, what does it mean to really, really serve? And I'm going to tell you the story because this is the only thing you guys remember tonight, because I know people, it's how they think. It was my junior year of college, right? I started to think, God, what do I really want? How do I really want to serve you, right? What are some ways I can really serve you? I was blessed my junior year, CEC, Life Fellowship, Lighthouse, and Harvest. We started doing homeless ministry together. It was actually really at homeless ministry that I really saw people really use their talents for God, right? One of the things I saw 17, 18, 19-year-olds go out and serve the homeless sending it, right? And it's kind of funny because like we're like 20-year-olds, most homeless are like 40, you know? And so it's funny that we sit down with them like, hey man, how's your life? We're like, well, I lost my job, I lost my kids. Like, we're like, oh yeah, I understand. You know, it's like, I don't understand, right? But it was just really awesome to see God use the 20-year-olds, right? To be able to, and people really shared with us too. You know, it was kind of crazy. But it was in that ministry that I can, again, really, really see God use people who are just underqualified, right? If I was running the San Diego Rescue Mission, I wouldn't hire 20-year-olds. I just didn't do that ministry, right? It's just, they're not qualified. They're too young to do it. But I really saw God use 20-year-olds to do the ministry. And also, here's a plug. I also met my wife. I'm not going to point her out, I just don't want to. I also met my wife in homeless ministry. And this is actually a plug for unity in the church, okay? I encourage you guys to do more stuff together as fellowships. Not because it's just fun to do stuff together as fellowships, but because there's a lot of things that we want to do at UCSD that can't be done with one fellowship. All right? Let me say this. If you're part of a ministry at a church, raise your hand. Part of any ministry. If any kind of ministry title, raise your hand. All right, that's a good amount of you, yeah. So if we're all honest in this room, okay, like I'm talking about like you are blogging and no one reads your blog. Okay, you would probably say, I'm frustrated. I would read at least one entry every blog and say, I'm frustrated. And we say that because there's things we want to do, but no one's come alongside of us, right? We're like, God, I have one bag of gold, what am I going to do? The purpose for unity, we don't seek unity for unity's sake. We seek unity because the things God calls us to do cannot be accomplished by ourselves. And I'm telling this from scripture, guys. God does not call us to be separate bodies, right? Jesus prays that we are one, like him and the Father are one, right? If any of you are frustrated in ministry, and you feel like the things that you want to do, no one's coming on board, you know why? It might be because God wants you to reach out to other fellowships. It might be because God wants you to go out and find people who are like-minded, like you, from other fellowships to work together. And I think that's a big problem in the Christian church. And I don't think it's because we're bad. I don't think it's just because we're having hate of being. Because why? It's really easy to be lazy. Alright? And I'll be honest here, okay? I think that all of you work hard, you all got to school. But it's really easy to be lazy. And the devil works in that laziness. It's really easy just to get frustrated. Alright? And to go on Twitter and just hate on people. Alright? I don't read any, like, Facebook updates or tweets after, like, midnight. Because that's just hate. And it's like really ambiguous or like really hateful stuff. Right? People are like, I understand love now. Da da da. Right? Or the dude like, you're such a jerk. Da da. You know, you're like, what? Alright. It's really easy to hate on people. Alright, it's really easy to be lazy. God is calling us to unity. I'm gonna show you again why it's bad and lazy. Let's go back to the text. Going back to the text, we are now in verse 26. And so his master, the master sees the servants' laziness, right? He sees that you guys are hitting the ground. So he says, Master replied, "You wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown, and gather where I have not scattered seed. Well then, you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers, so that when I returned, I would have received it back with interest." So here's crazy. So take the bag of gold from him, give it to the one who has 10 bags. For whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken from them. And throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. When you first read the story, right, like you don't think it's gonna, the story isn't end the way it is. Right? When you first read the story, you might think, look, it's gonna be a story about making money. Okay, master, he's a businessman, he wants to make money. Halfway through the story, you notice something. Right, halfway through the story, you realize, like, man, the guy has one bag of gold, leave him alone, right? He's not that much talent, just leave this guy alone. Matthew comes back and says to him, what? You wicked, hold on a second. Every word in the Bible is there for a reason. Why wicked? Why does he say wicked? Because what God says, he says, Master, I know you're a hard man, so I put it in the ground. Right? And the guy's scared of the master. The master comes back and says, you're wicked for doing it. I want us to extrapolate, just take that from out of the story, think about our lives. Right? Are we wicked for wasting the things that God has given us? Okay. Are we wicked for wasting the things that God has given us? I think so. Alright? I think so. Because here's what we're doing, right? And it's not because we're trying to do bad things, right? But here's what we're doing. Because here's an example of how we pray. God, you have given me this wonderful gift of prayer. I can talk to the King of the universe. You created everything out of nothing. God, I like this girl. She liked me. And she told me that maybe sometimes well, I don't understand what's going on. So God, I really need you just to make sure that the dance coming out and go there. Right? And by the way, I hope my friend's not saved. Can you please hear them? All right? Or God, this quarter, I have just so much more free time. I only take in like 8 units this quarter. I have so much time to like just do things for the kingdom. So this is job I want. You know, it's like Del Taco. I like that place. I really need this job. Right. I know my church needs worship leaders and stuff. I really want to work at Del Taco because I'll get free tacos. Think about why it's wicked. Think about why it's wicked. Okay, some of you laugh at that, right? The God of the universe has given us himself. Why? So that we can enjoy God. The things that God has given us is so that we can enjoy the ultimate joy in the universe is God himself. And when we worship him, when we help build our churches, we enjoy and worship God. But what do we do with it? We use prayer for secular things. Right? We use the talents and all the gifts God has given us for secular things. We say, God, you called me to be a doctor, so I need to make 6 figures, I need a big house, I need a car, and that's my calling in life. Right? And God is saying, worship me. Right? The door of the universe. I have everything. I can give me out of nothing. You're like, God, I have this house that I want to get. Right? I need these talents for this house. The wickedness in the Christian life comes from the fact that we use the things of God for the things of the world. That's what wickedness is. There's another adjective in this section, right? Which is lazy. Servant is lazy. And again, I've been in ministry a while. I know people are lazy for laziness' sake, right? I think there is spiritual warfare whenever we try to do ministry. I don't know how many of you guys feel it, right? Some of you guys just, you know, think that meetings and stuff are not very spiritual warfare-ish. It's just meetings and stuff. There is a spiritual warfare going on. And the biggest weapon Satan uses is laziness, right? It's laziness. And I seriously wanted you to be honest with yourself, okay? In the years that you've done ministry at UCSD, how many times have you thought about doing your ministry alongside another fellowship? Alright? How many times have you thought about bringing other people from other fellowships along to do ministry? To do magic, let's do it together. It's hard, right? You gotta call them up and be like, hey, let's meet on this day. If it doesn't work out for you, let's do another day. Oh, let me talk to your pastor, let me do this, you know, proposal. It's hard, right? And how many of you quit? How many of you had great ideas and just quit? Why? one goes to weddings and stuff. Never happens. Okay, it's hard. But I'm telling you from Scripture. Alright, I'm telling you from Scripture. The devil is against you, but he who is for us is greater than he who is against us. Alright? The people in this room, guys, I want to encourage you that God has given you everything you need to fight weakness, to fight laziness. Right? Don't fall into that trap. When I was looking at this text, I was looking at the last part of this text. And it's actually really hard for me, right? Because I was like, dude, just like you guys, like, this is really serious. You look at verse 30. And throw that worthless servant, right? Yeah, that's really me. I'm worthless. Right? Throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness where they'll be weeping and gnashing their teeth. So hold on a second. Some of you guys jump right away. First of all, why is it darkness outside? Right? Why is it darkness outside? I'm talking at night and there's like no candles outside. Right? And why is there weeping and gnashing of teeth outside? What is going on outside? Where are they living? What kind of neighborhood are they in? When there are like wolves and eternal darkness outside. That's a bad neighborhood, you need to move out of there. Alright, maybe get on a camel, go somewhere else. Right? And this is where the story gets crazy, right? This is where Jesus starts jumping the stories. Throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness where there'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth. When I was thinking about this message, I was thinking like, man, I don't want to go this direction. You know, it's going to be really a big downer for the IPCN to start the year. I was trying to like think of a positive way to spin this. And I know after like a lot of hours, I can't spin this positive way. The reality is, okay, you are in your ministry positions for a reason. God is using you guys to rescue people from hell. And I mean that in different ways. You're rescuing people from hell because some people come to this campus, right? We have like a huge flux of exchange students, right? From countries who have no Bible, who have no churches. And they're coming here and they have a chance to hear the gospel. And you have that chance to reach out to them. Also, there's some Christians who are coming to UCSD where they're, you know, they've been to church a couple times, my cousin is a Christian, but they are not really looking for a fellowship. You have an opportunity to make a community for them. To make them love the church of God. To make them love the people of God. All right, you can think about it. All I do is hand out flyers, right? All I do is hand out announcements at church. You can have an opportunity to welcome them, right, to the house of God. And to show excitement and passion for the things of God. I don't think that, you know, when you're in college, if you drink and you like go to parties and stuff, you automatically go to hell. Okay? That's not in the Bible. Why do you think college ministry is serious? Is because those things, bad things, right? I'm not saying drinking is always bad, right? But there's a lot of things you can do in college that can lead you away from God. And that's why hell is such a reality on college campuses. Because there are things on college campuses that can lead you away from God. There are distractions that can lead you away from God. I'm talking about Christian people, okay? Christian people. There are things on this campus that can lead you away from God. The reason we do ministry is to focus our eyes back on God. We don't do ministry because we want to just give people enough to drink, right? We do ministry because we want to worship God. And there's a level of seriousness in what we do. Right? I remember when I was in college, I think it was my sophomore year, there was four suicides in two weeks. Right? Like UCSD had like a suicide control hotline and all this stuff. And I know a lot of people were just really struggling because a lot of people knew the guys who committed suicide. Four suicides in 2 weeks. I think they're like warring and like rebelling. Right? And a lot of Christian fellowships, like, if someone took it really seriously, why did you commit suicide? Right? Probably name a dozen reasons. Alright? I guarantee you they might have had a chance if they were in fellowship, if they were with people who loved them, who cared for them, and say, you know what, there's a God in the universe who loves you, and I'm here to show you that he loves you. I think that might have made a difference. Alright? There is a level of seriousness in college. I know it's really fun in college. Okay, but there's a level of seriousness here. And talking about unity, why the seriousness we see unity. When I'm in China doing ministry, right, I always get scared, you know, because I'm like Asian American. So like people speak to me in Chinese, they're like, you know, ni hao, I mean so da da da, and I'm like, oh shoot, right? Like, yes? And I'm like, I'm not Chinese, I'm from America. They're like, you can't read, ha 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 ha, you can't read. I was like, you can't read English. Right? And I'm always afraid they're just gonna like call me out. Like, oh, you're so terrible, you're 21 years old, you can never do ministry, right? You're like sympathetic. But it's kind of funny, and actually, when you're overseas, for some reason, you work together a lot better. You know, I do ministry in America, right? It's hard. Okay, some of you guys think about becoming, you know, full-time ministers. When you become full-time ministry, no one ever returns your phone calls, all right? Or returns your emails. Because all your emails are like, hey, you want to be a missionary, you want to do that, but like, never return your email, all right? When I'm overseas, though, for some reason, you work together better. And the reason only I can come up with is because missionaries understand the seriousness of what they're doing. Right, Shanghai is a city of about 21 million people. 70% of them are from provinces outside of Shanghai, right, which usually have no church. 21 million people, right? Most churches are sized like 50. How many churches of 50 do you need to cover 21 million people? A lot, okay, I don't know the number, but I'm not an engineer, it's a lot. So when missionaries go to the field, right, and say you were successful, your first year plant church of 200 people, 21 million people. You go on the streets and you see a woman begging, and her face is just burned, right? And there's no safety net for people who have no physical disabilities or burn victims, begging on the street. I've seen, walking in the subways, I see like little girls like 5 years old begging for food, right? And by the way, she dresses like a town, she's not from Shanghai, she's from like a province outside of Shanghai. She came to the city, she can't, you know, family's poor, so she's begging for money in the subway. And when missionaries see that, you start thinking like, look, me and you will disagree. Right, if we're back in the States, we're just arguing every day about theology, we argue about how we do worship, how we like print bulletins out, what color to print bulletins, right? There's so many things to argue about. But because we're here, right, and I know that little girl will never hear about Jesus Christ unless we work together. Let's work together. And it's funny because like when you're overseas, right, you get on a plane, you understand that. But if you don't get on a plane, you can't understand that. I want us to understand that. I want us to not have to get on the plane to understand that we are rescuing people from hell. I want us not to go overseas to understand that there are people on this campus who have never heard of Jesus Christ, right? Who maybe in 6 months will go back to a country that has no Bible, that has no churches. And for some of you guys are just thinking of all the obstacles in ministry, right? Or for this freshman, you think about your four-year plan, you're just thinking about your career. Jesus calls the servant wicked and lazy, right? I just defined it for you. Wickedness is not just, you know, doing bad things. It's using the things God has given you for secular purpose. And laziness is not because you're trying to be lazy, right? It's because the devil is against you. The devil is against the ministries on this campus. But I'm encouraging you guys, fight. All right? And in a second, we're gonna open up the back to all the fellowships. I hope everyone gets plugged into the fellowship, all right? Freshmen, junior transfers, get into a fellowship. Probably because it's really lame to be at home, you know, like Friday night, on Facebook, watching a couple of online. Second of all, right, people in this room have worked really hard to make their churches really inviting for you. So I encourage you guys to get plugged into your church. Because I saw a lot of hands for people who are in ministry. Can I really encourage you guys? I'm not sure if this has really been done before IPCN. Can I encourage you guys, for the ministries that you're really passionate about, and there must be tons of them, right? Like worship ministry, welcoming, outreach to internationals, outreach to like surfers, whatever, right? Can I encourage you guys, find people who want to do ministry with you, all right? Just plug, I found my wife that way, all right? That's not what you do it. I'm just saying, you follow God, good things will happen to you, all right? But because I know that it's frustrating by yourself to do these ministries, trust me, there are people in this room who will partner with you. And I'm being honest with you, it won't happen right away, right? You're gonna Facebook tag each other, phone call tag each other, it's gonna be really tough. Can I encourage you guys to work hard at it? All right? I hope this night doesn't end at this message. I hope this night goes on to the back of the room. I hope conversations will happen. I hope God is convicting you of things you're passionate for right now. I hope there's people, students, some of your friends who are in your mind right now, as I'm speaking, and you're thinking like, man, I haven't been doing my job, reach out to them. I hope that's out of mind. And I hope that you take that home, right? And that God continues to help you to pursue those people, right? A lot of people get saved in college. A lot of people actually find their calling in college, right? It's kind of interesting. When I left the Marines, you know, one of the early things that I thought was like, what am I really going to do? When I left, I was about 21 years old. I thought to myself, what am I really going to do? Is my own life going to do anything? In the last 6 years in China, I've had the chance to probably baptize maybe 20 to 30 people. Right? Not because I'm a good evangelist, but because I've been part of their church. Because they see me that I've come and brought people to them, helped serve them. I baptized 30 people. And again, 21 million, right? It's not a huge percentage of that. Those 30 people were going straight to hell. And somehow some people, 20-year-olds from the U.S., came, showed them the gospel, showed them the love of Christ, and now they're God's kingdom. I don't know what God's going to do with you guys. All right? I hope if you feel underqualified, that's what you should be. Right? That's the feeling that you need, because God uses people who are underqualified. If you're overqualified, you need to pray. Please, tone that down. And again, I really encourage you guys, go to the back, network, make friends. All right, let's pray. Father God, I thank you for this night. Lord, I believe that everyone here is here because you want them to see your scripture, to see your word. So God, I pray that you burn your word to their hearts so that the people in the ministries that they're thinking of right now are not forgotten after this night. Oh God, we ask for a burden. God, we ask for a level of seriousness. Not that it can be fun, but God, that there's a purpose behind why we're here in college. I pray that people's 4 years planned here are not based on their career, but based on you. God, I pray that every gift here is used for you. So bless us now. Let us know your Son, and let us walk in your Spirit. Fill us with your spirits. In Jesus' name we pray.